Work. Thank you. Well, again, I want to join the other speakers in thanking the organizers for giving me the privilege of speaking in this memorial to Cyrano. And it's, of course, been a great, very interesting program so far. I hope I'll keep you awake for the next 45 minutes as well. I'll be talking about something rather different than what most of the other speakers have talked about. It doesn't have anything to do with spin glasses. It's quite quantum mechanical, and it's specifically, I'm going to be talking about quantum Hall systems, which I guess we'll refer to very briefly in the last slide. These are, of course, two-dimensional electron systems in very strong magnetic fields, and specifically the cases I'm going to be talking about have been studied in gallium arsenide two-dimensional layers. I should say that I've never written any papers with Cyrano. I first got to know him in 1965, so quite a number of years ago, when I was a postdoc at the École Normale Supérieure, and I was actually in the group of Nozière. Cyrano, who was at Saclay at the time, I guess, came several days a week and gave a lecture series on quantum many-body theory, which he was, of course, famous for at the time. And yes, there were a lot of diagrams, and it was quite complicated, but it was very informative to me. And what I'll be talking about has at least some relation to the quantum many-body theory and Fermi liquid theory and the relations between them. The other time, I didn't really get to know him then, because he was a teacher. I was just one student, a postdoctoral student in the class. But then I came back in 1982. I was here. I had a sabbatical in Paris for 4 months. Primarily, Edouard Brézin was my host, and I spent several days a week at Saclay and several days a week at ENS. But of course, Cyrano was at Saclay, and we spoke a lot. And I was somewhat interested in, I had done some work in spin glasses at the time, and he was really running far ahead of me, but I had a lot of interesting discussions with him at that time, and also became friends. So I'm really pleased to be here and to pay tribute to him. Okay, now let's see how this works. So, okay, great. So I really want to be talking about two related topics. Both of them are issues related to particle hole symmetry, or the lack thereof, for electrons in a Landau level in a strong magnetic field. The first part of my talk will be somewhat detailed about the nature of states at filling fraction 1/2 and nearby quantized fractions. And the second part, which will be a bit briefer probably, we'll talk about the nature of the even denominator fractional quantized Hall state, which has been observed at filling fraction 5/2, which is now in the second Landau level, and the implication of recent measurements of the thermal Hall effect and what they have to say about this. So let me tell you about the particle Hall symmetry, what that means in a partially filled Landau level. If you take the limit, what we're interested in is a bunch of interacting electrons in a strong magnetic field where the kinetic energy is quantized into discrete Landau levels. And we're dealing with a situation where the Fermi level is in the middle of some Landau level. So in the absence of electron-electron interactions, you have an enormous degeneracy of states. You can fill them all up in different ways, and they all have exactly the same energy. And the the electron-electron interaction has a very big effect because it can split this degeneracy, but it's a very hard problem to know how to, you'd have to diagonalize some enormous matrix if you were trying to do it exactly. But one simplification is if the electron-electron interaction is relatively weak compared to the cyclotron energy, which happens if you let the bare mass of the electrons go to zero, what makes the cyclotron energy big. Well, you keep the electron-electron interaction fixed. The electron-electron interaction fixes the scale of the energies you're interested in, and you can forget about the other Landau levels. So there's no mixing between Landau levels. And in that limit, where you, if you have just two body interactions and electrons are confined to a single Landau level, then there's an exact particle-hole symmetry. You can make a mathematical transformation between something that has, say, some fraction nu of the Landau level and one minus nu, and there's a one-to-one correspondence. They're basically, the energy levels are identical except for some smooth function, which you can take into account, and all the energy gaps the same, and there are relations between the transport properties of these systems and so forth. And of course, if nu is equal to half, then the system is, the Hamiltonian, or the effective Hamiltonian, is symmetric in itself. And this has consequences on the transport and other things. So, and of course, there'll always be some Landau level mixing in real life because the mass isn't exactly zero, but it's actually typically a small perturbation. And in any case, even if it wasn't all that small in practice, if you're trying to understand what happens, it's a good starting point, and a good theory should be able to describe accurately the limit projection onto the lowest Landau level. So now, as I say, there are two situations we want to talk about. So first of all, near filling fraction a half. That's where the Fermi level is in the lowest Landau level. Experimentally, it's been known for a long time that you do not see a quantized Hall plateau. There are, of course, a vast number of quantum Hall states that have been observed. Almost all of them are states where the filling fraction has odd denominator. And nu equals a half, it's quite smooth. The resistance varies continuously. It's finite. There's no energy for no evidence for an energy gap, no plateau. And so it looks, in some sense, in transport, very boring. But it was also found that the state is not trivial. In 1990, Willett and companies observed that there were some very strange anomalies in the propagation of surface acoustic waves. That was sort of the first hint that there's something really interesting going on. And that caused us to think in greater detail about what was going on. And the picture that evolved at that time is based on the common starting point for understanding pretty much what happens in the lowest Landau level more generally nowadays, the current starting point, which is the composite fermion picture of Jane. And I'll tell you about that a little bit more later. But it was then reformulated by Jane's formulation in terms of trial wave functions was reformulated by Lopez and Fradkin in terms of system of non-relativistic fermions interacting with a so-called Chern-Simons gauge potential. It's kind of a fake magnetic field. I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Patrick Lee and Nick Reed and I applied this to the state, this unquantized but quantum Hall of state at nu equals a half, and also the nearby filling fractions that with the ones where there are nearby states where there are fractions with odd denominator, near to nu equals a half, where there are quantized Hall states. And what happens in this model, and I'll tell you a little more about that later, is that you're attaching these, you have this fake magnetic field, the Chern-Simons field, which is a sort of an emergent quantum field, and you have two flux quanta attached to each electron, and on average, that exactly cancels the external magnetic field in at filling fraction a half, so that in some very low mean field approximation, what you find are non-interacting fermions, and you can describe without any magnetic field, and the ground state is something like a new a Fermi sea of non-relativistic spinless particles interacting weakly, hopefully, or relatively weakly, with the remaining fluctuations in the in the Chern-Simons gauge field and the Coulomb interactions, and you hope that this is the right basis for describing the system. And that's what we did, and you make various predictions from it, which, as I, many of which agreed very well with experiment. But there's an issue, which was pointed out a long time ago, is that the model, this theory, which I'll call the HLR theory, does not look particle hole symmetric in any way. It is, and but we know that from numerical calculations and experiments, there's no indication that there's any kind of spontaneous breaking of this particle hole symmetry at nu equals a half. So you expect the system to be particle hole symmetric, and if this HLR theory is not compatible with particle hole symmetry, then that would be a serious problem. And people worried about that. And in 2015, D.T. Sohn formulated a new theory of half-filled Landau level, which instead of using non-relativistic particles, he introduced, he pulled out of his hat, a model which had a Fermi C of massless Dirac fermions, and it's interacting with a slightly different kind of gauge field, but also with a synthetic gauge field. And his model was manifestly particle hole symmetric. So, of course, that produced particle hole symmetric results. And the question that arose then is, are these two theories actually the same, even though they look very different? Do they make the same predictions, or are they fundamentally different? And so there are a lot of, there were different views on this. And so I can tell you the short answer of what we believe and why the problem is still complicated. So, let's say that what I'm talking about was a work done with Chang Wang, who was a postdoc at a junior fellow at Harvard, and Nigel Cooper and Adi Stern appeared about a year ago, and what we found was that when you did things carefully, almost all the properties that you might want to calculate are the same in the two theories. And these include several properties which people had widely believed were different, that the two theories were incompatible. I'll give you a couple of examples. And for these properties where we found agreement, we concluded that, in fact, the reason they agree is that there is an emergent particle hole symmetry, which will occur in the real physical system when you go to the limit of filling fraction a half, even if the microscopic model is not particle hole symmetric, because after all, we certainly didn't assume a particle hole symmetric model in deriving the HLR theory. On the other hand, even though we showed this, and there were three things that everyone believed the HLR theory wouldn't give you properly, Sohn and collaborators showed that there were other properties, there's still other properties, more subtle properties, where the theories do disagree. And so the open question is, can these properties be recovered now in HLR if you go beyond the simple RPA type approximation, which were used for all of these analyses? And when I say RPA, so the calculations basically that we do is we have a model that we're an effective theory that you evaluate in what I'll call an RPA level. By RPA, it's a random phase approximation. It's basically just a time-dependent mean field theory where you have a bunch of free fermions that move in some kind of self-consistent field, which includes, of course, the average Coulomb potential, but also has to include these gauge fields, which when you have currents, you generate gauge fields and so forth, and they have to be all done self-consistently. And in addition to this, just as in ordinary Fermi-liquid theory, if you want to get the correct energy scale, you have to use renormalized masses or renormalized Fermi velocity, and you need Landau interaction parameters and so forth. That you get the same, you need the same kind of renormalization whether you're doing Sohn-Dirac theory or in any of these theories, because you don't know what the bare parameter, you can't use the bare parameters. But it's not very relevant for what I want to talk about. And so our current understanding is that in those properties where the theories disagree at the RPA level, they're probably not universal. They're presumably not universal. And they're things that actually shouldn't show particle hole symmetry unless the model is particle hole symmetric. And what we hope or we think is that you should be able to calculate these properties within this old HLR theory, but you have to go beyond RPA, and it's necessary to include what we call vertex corrections, not exactly the same as what was used before, but basically what we mean are the corrections to the coupling constants when you go away from the limit of long wavelengths or zero frequency. And in general, when you introduce these vertex corrections, which are necessary, by the way, in Sohn-Dirac as well as HLR, except that many of them are zero by symmetry in that case, whereas for us, you have to put them in with appropriate parameters. In general, these vertex corrections depend on parameters that you don't know a priori, but you'd have to calculate them from the microscopic theory, and they'll depend on the microscopic theory, and hopefully if you choose, if the microscopic theory is particle hole symmetric, it'll give you the right value of these vertex corrections to repair the discrepancies. And we've identified some corrections which could do it, but we are not sure yet. It's not clear whether these corrections can actually emerge from a microscopic model, the proper microscopic model, so this is very much an open question and a source of debate. So I sort of gave you the general picture. Let me just give you an example of the kinds of predictions that where Sohn-Dirac and RPA and the HLR do agree at the RPA level, and some of them are rather non-trivial. Of course, so the first thing is that the ground state at nu equals a half is a Fermi C, whether it's a Fermi C of Dirac particles or non-relativistic ones, so it's compressible. If you go look at the fractional quantum Hall states close to nu equals a half, the important ones are these Jane fractions, which have the form of nu is equal to p over 2p plus 1, where p is a positive or negative integer, and this gives you a series of odd denominator fractions which are symmetric about nu equals a half. And the energy gaps that you predict, you can predict at least the relative sizes of the energy gaps for the positive and negative ones, and they're symmetric about a half in both theories. That part comes out the same, so there's an emergence particle symmetry in a sense there. The transport in the absence of impurities, the DC Hall conductance at nu equals a half is just 1/2 of E squared over H. A very non-trivial, what was I think the first really non-trivial thing that we found back in 1992, is if you look at the longitudinal electrical conductivity, that's the response to a longitudinal electric field at wave vector Q in the limit of omega goes to zero, it has a peculiar form. It looks like the wave vector Q over 2 pi times the 8 pi times the Fermi wavelength. It's a universal constant times Q is the wave vector. And the fact that it's wave vector dependent in the singular way means that the conductivity is a non-local conductivity. If you the response at some point is determined by in a funny way by the electric field at some distant point, this is what would happen in the absence of impurities. If you have impurities, then there's some mean free path, and when Q is, that should be bigger than the inverse of the mean free path. For small values, then it goes to some constant that's determined by the scattering length. But this is at Q equals exactly at a half. If you go slightly away from a half, then this is cut off by the magnetic field, and you get oscillations as a function of Q and B. And these are responsible for these strange things that were seen by the this divergent part was what was responsible for the anomaly in the surface acoustic wave experiment that was seen by Willett et al., which basically measures this quantity And then later experiments actually showed the oscillations that the theory we predicted. And Dirac theory predicts exactly the same behavior. At a somewhat more subtle level, sort of 1 degree higher in particle hole symmetry, and this is something that for many years people thought was a problem, is the following. If you have a model of where you project at the lowest lambda level, and you assume that the and you start adding impurities, then of course you're going to get some scattering, and you'll get a finite conductivity, which will be depend on the scattering rate. But if it's particle hole symmetric, and if the impurities are particle hole symmetric, so you have equal numbers of positive and negative impurities, then you can show rigorously that the Hall conductance should be exactly 1/2 E squared over H, which is 1 over 4 pi in units where you said H bar equals 1. This value should be true at all frequencies and independent of the impurities. That's a remarkable consequence of particle hole symmetry. And particle hole symmetry means, let's say, the average impurity potential should be zero and all the odd moments are zero. And there were strong doubts about whether this was compatible with the HLR theory that dated back to 1997, when Kivelson showed that in the simplest approximation, the HLR theory appears to give deviations from particle hole symmetry. They're small because they're proportional to the square of the impurity scattering rate, rather than whereas the longitudinal the conductance goes as the just as the square of the as the linearly. So it's a small effect, but if you're interested in theory, then it's an important issue. I think experimentally it's not a measurable deviation, but what we found remarkably is that you just have to do the RPA calculation more carefully. You have to include small corrections from the fact that you have both fluctuations in the effective magnetic field and in the real potential. And if you the fluctuations in the real potential are small, but if you throw them away, you're throwing the baby away with the bathwater. If you put them in, you get the right answer. So even at the RPA level, we got remarkably, we restored this. We never assumed anything about the bare mass, so it suggests that there's an emergent particle hole symmetry. And there were several other properties that we also obtained that were people believed were not correct. One of them had to do with the location of the minima in the magneto-roton energy spectrum. Whether they're symmetric at filling fractions about nu equals 1/2. I won't talk about that, but a related thing, which is also related to these oscillations that I mentioned in the longitudinal conductivity, is actually related to experiments. It's something called Weiss oscillations. And these are resistance minima as a function of the density near a nu equals 1/2 in the presence of an external periodic potential with wave vector q. For the phonons, it was the wave vector of the q of the phonon came in. Here it's a wave vector that's set by artificially putting down a grating. And so this is actually a theoretical curve based on Sohn-Dirac theory. So this is automatically particle hole symmetric, but HLR theory, if you do it properly, and again, you have to take into account second order corrections just properly within the RPA theory, you get a curve that's indistinguishable, and the minima are the same places. And what am I plotting here? So what's happening here is this is exactly at filling fraction 1/2, and here I'm varying the electron density, keeping the magnetic field fixed. And that's where you expect to get particle hole symmetry. And these curves, these minima, are related to the commensurability with the period of the lattice. If I change the period of my lattice, this scale would expand or shrink. It's not an intrinsic, it's not intrinsic to the electron gas except in the presence of the impurities. And roughly speaking, it happens when the wavelength, I'll give you an, say that in a minute. So, and there are experiments, the beautiful experiments done by the Princeton group and Shayegan's group, where they actually see these oscillations, and the positions of the minima that they see are indicated by these vertical lines here in their experiment. They agree pretty closely, but not exactly. There are shifts, and these shifts are of the order of what you might have predicted if you thought, if you did the HLR theory wrong, but the shifts are symmetric. So there are some discrepancies between the prediction of the theory and what's seen experimentally, and there could be a lot of reasons for that, but particle hole symmetry does seem to be present experimentally and theoretically, and so if you can't distinguish between the theories that way, because they both make the same prediction. And roughly speaking, what's going on here is that at exactly at nu equals zero, the electrons are these composite fermions. Even though they're in a very strong magnetic field, the composite fermions see an average zero field, so they travel in straight lines. Okay, and that's why you get a non-local conductivity, because they can travel of the distance of maybe half a micron, which is almost it's 50 times the magnetic length. So the actual electrons are only travel a few tens of nanometers before they go in a circle. But these composite particles can actually travel over very long distances at nu equals a half. If you go away from nu equals a half, you're adding an extra little of magnetic field, and then these particles go in circles. And these minima occur roughly when when a cyclotron diameter is commensurate with when you have a finite an integer number, actually it's an integer number plus a quarter, because it's a Bessel function. When there's an integer plus a quarter number of cyclotron diameters inside a wavelength. Okay, but as I said, there are also properties that do not show emergent particle hole symmetry, one of them is if you calculate this conductivity tensor, sigma ij of q, there's a q squared correction to this conductivity tensor, which does not come out right in if you use HLR at the level of RPA. There's some problem there, and we don't know. That's what one of the things we're trying to repair. And then some similar things that they're typically higher order in Q corrections to what's going on at filling fraction a half. Right. Okay, so so why are there two theories in the first place? Why should you believe, where did HLR come from, and what is it that Sohn Dirac, that Sohn did knew? Just very quickly, to remind you what the problem is that we're actually trying to solve in detail. I mean, you know it's electrons at the lowest lambda level. So we want to think about a system where you have electrons described, it's electrons in a semiconductor, so we're assuming a parabolic band that's completely spin polarized. So I have a kinetic energy, which is sum on the electrons, P minus the vector potential divided by 2m. M is actually not the bare, it's the band mass of an electron, so it's renormalized by the band structure, but it's not normalized by the electron-electron interaction. And then there's a two-body interaction, which is the Coulomb interaction, and the vector potential here is just the vector potential due to a uniform magnetic field. And okay, we can use units where E is equal to H is equal to 1, H bar is equal to 1. And what we did was to begin with an exact transformation, which is it's a singular gauge transformation. It's just multiplying the wave function by a phase factor, which depends on the positions of all of the electrons in a complicated way. And when you do that, of course, if you it's a you have a phase basically which winds to 4 pi as you go around each electron. And of course, if you want to change the phase, you have to change the Hamiltonian so that you get the right answer. And that what it means is that in addition to the external gauge field, you have to introduce this, that's what I call this artificial, this fake Chern-Simons field A of Ri. And this A vector potential depends on the position of all the other particles as if you attach the solenoid with 2 flux quanta to the position of each particle. So it falls off as 1 over R. And of course, the important thing is the curl of this vector potential is minus 4 pi times the density of electrons. This is an operator, of course, so this is a very complicated thing. But if you just replace this by its average quantity, as you would in a mean field theory, then this at nu equals 1/2, it just cancels the external magnetic field. And as I said, then in mean field theory, the ground state, of course, then the Coulomb interaction is also just a constant, so we can set it equal to 0, because it's just the average Coulomb interaction. We have an infinite system. And the hope is that you can start from this mean field theory and get the real results by perturbation theory, in which you take into account by perturbation fluctuations in the gauge field and the Coulomb interactions using diagrams, just as Cyrano would have taught us to do. But of course, this is a strong coupling problem, and we can't really do that. We can only hope that the results will be similar to what you get in Landau-Fermi liquid theory. Okay, and of course, it assumes that you can move from the ground, from the mean field state to the ground state by some adiabatic continuation without encountering a phase transition, which isn't necessarily right, but at least that's what we hope. And the RPA with the effective mass correction is the first step along these lines. So that's where that came from. And the Sohn-Dirac theory, by contrast, started with a model which wasn't a physical model. It started with a model in which you suppose you have a single species of massless two-dimensional Dirac particles, fermions, with some microscopically particle hole symmetric, which is therefore microscopically particle hole symmetric. And suppose you could start with this and renormalize this and get some kind of effective interaction, which of course would be automatically particle hole symmetric. But the argument is that he made was, well, it shouldn't make any difference that you have this artificial starting problem, because the difference between microscopic models shouldn't matter in the limit where you're projecting onto only one Landau level anyway. And okay, and then he introduced the gauge field by a slightly different method than HLR, in a way that's a little bit more general but approximate, but I don't think that makes any difference. So anyway, that's where we are. As I say, there are open questions. This is the first half of my talk, anyway. One question is, what does it really mean for two theories such as HLR and Sohn-Dirac to be equivalent? They're supposed to be, these theories are supposed to be effective theories. They're supposed to be low-energy theories. They're supposed to describe low-energy properties of electrons in a Landau level at or near half filling. But what do you include? What properties are they supposed to describe exactly? What ones would you have to include corrections? Is there a way of introducing vertex corrections that make the theories identical, and can we derive them from a microscopic model? Yeah?
I must have omitted something, but why do you call this an effective
Chern-Simons? If I wrote it in a Hamiltonian form, if I wrote it as a Lagrangian, it would have a Chern-Simons term, and that's what gives you when you take the variational derivative and set it equal to 0 with a Chern-Simons term, it gives you exactly this constraint that the curl of A is equal to 4 pi times the density. So it can be written in Lagrangian form. That is the standard form, but we didn't start out that way because we were condensed matter theory. Right. And the transformation is made, we did it in a particular gauge, which was a gauge which the divergence is 0 and the Coulomb gauge, basically. So, but it can be written. Okay, so I have just a few minutes left. Let me talk about the second lambda level. So here, the problem is somewhat the opposite. So as I say, in the second lambda level, there is a quantized Hall plateau at filling fraction 5/2. That it's second lambda level because the first lambda level, the spin up and spin down electrons are filled. So you have 2 electrons there, and you have half an electron per flux quantum in the second lambda level. And there's a lot of evidence that it's completely spin polarized. So it should be a particle holds, it's a situation where you might expect particle hole symmetry to be at least a pretty good approximation. A quantized Hall plateau was observed in 87, and there was debate about what was going on. But since the late 90s, everyone thought they understood what was going on, there was a state, a so-called Pfaffian state proposed by Moore and Reed in 1991. Numerical calculations showed that this seemed to have a very good overlap with what was seen in finite size system calculations. So that emerged as the overwhelming candidate. Then it was also noted, though, that, you know, we noted it actually, there's another state, the Pfaffian state, as it's written down, is obviously not particle hole symmetric. But not only is it not particle hole symmetric, if you look at the particle hole conjugate of it, which is we call the anti-Pfaffian, not only is it different in the trial wave function, but it's fundamentally different in that you cannot continue one to the other without closing an energy gap. They're really topologically different. So they really are different states. And in particular, they make different prediction. They have, of course, the same nu equals the same Hall conductance, and they both have non-abelian fraction excitations, and most of the excitations are similar, but what happens at the boundary is very different, because what one predicts is that they have different values of the quantized Hall thermal Hall conductance. These are states which have exactly the same energy in any model which you ignore lambda level mixing, because the model is, if the Hamiltonian is particle hole symmetric, they have to have exactly the same model. And you can only decide between them by very small corrections. The problem is that these thermal Hall conductance, which we proposed a long time ago, they're very hard to do. And only recently have they been done. The experiments, particularly last year, were finally done at nu equals 5/2 by the Weitzman group. And the results do not agree with the predictions of either the Pfaffian state or the anti-Pfaffian state. I'll explain that in a moment. So the question is really wide open of what's going on. Now, what is this quantized Hall conductance? So what you can show is that if you have a system which is gapped in the bulk, so there's no heat conduction through the bulk, there's no energy gap, all the heat conduction happens along the sides. And so it's all determined by the nature, by how many modes there are propagating on each side. When you work that out, you find that the Hall conductance, or the thermal conductance really in the two contact geometry, can be written as some dimensionless number times kappa naught times t, where kappa naught is just a bunch of this combination of fundamental constants. So this is, of course, completely arbitrary, except for this assumes that this says that the heat, it should go proportional to temperature. What it turns out when you analyze all of these theories is that kappa, this k, is actually a quantum number, which is related to the net chiral central charge in a conformal field theory description of the edge states. And these typically, in all the simple fractions, the odd denominator fractions, or in integers, integer quantum Hall states, this k is an integer. And it just describes the difference between the number of left-moving modes and right-moving modes. Each one can carry a heat conductance of 1 times kappa naught T. It doesn't depend on what the charge of the mode is. All these modes look like bosonic modes. They all conduct the same, except in systems which have non-abelian excitations. There's very weird excitations where when you move one around the other, you get a different state. And the most important ones are the Pfaffian, anti-Pfaffian state, which are predicted to have non-abelian statistics. And they have, in addition to these phonon-like modes, they have modes at the edge which are Majorana fermions. And the Majorana fermion mode contributes only half of what an ordinary electron mode would carry. So you can get non-integer values in systems which support excitations with non-abelian statistics. Majorana, in this case, the Pfaffian state is supposed to have k equals 7/2. The anti-Pfaffian is supposed to have k equals 3/2. And the experiments gave k equals 5/2, halfway in between. So the question is, could you have a state with, one possibility is that, well, maybe it's some different state. And indeed, a state which has electrical conductivity 5/2 and this k equals 5/2 was proposed by Sohn in the same paper, which he called the particle hole symmetric Pfaffian. And related states have been proposed in other contexts by other authors. But the problem is that none of the numerical calculations on finite side systems produced anything that looked like this state. The ground state always was either the Pfaffian or the anti-Pfaffian, or with some slight energy difference between them, including calculations on finite systems and density matrix for normalization group systems. So there's a problem. And there are three possibilities, of course, which one is that the experiments are wrong, or that they've been misinterpreted, or that they haven't really had enough equilibration, and one can argue about that. The other is that numerical calculations are wrong, and that's also possible because they're also done on some finite size, and maybe they just haven't gone to large enough systems. And then there's a third possibility, is that, well, maybe experiments are right, and the numerical calculations are right in an ideal system where there are no impurities, but maybe if you put a lot of disorder in, you could stabilize some other phase, and maybe you could even stabilize this pH Pfaffian stage. And various authors, including us, have looked at that. And this is with Chang Wang and Ashvin Vishwanath. We find that it's possible in principle, if you adjust things properly, to get something like a pH Pfaffian phase with the right quantum numbers. But it seems to be very difficult to achieve with realistic parameters. At least we think it is. For weak disorder, we would expect to find just a simple first order transition where if you varied parameters, you get either the Pfaffian or it jumps to being anti-Pfaffian and you don't get anything in between. If you have strong disorder, you can get an intermediate phase, which could have a quantum number, could have a quantized Hall conductance, but even more likely would be something which didn't have a quantized Hall conductance at all. You would have something where you could get what we call a quantized Hall thermal metal. This was introduced by other previously, but in which you have still a quantized Hall conductance. So you're on the plateau and you have electrical conductivity, nu equals 1/2, but now you have the possibility of neutral excitations propagating in the bulk. So the bulk, it's an insulator for charge propagation, but you can have the basically Majorana fermions traveling along the domain walls between different domains, and that would give you a finite conductance in the bulk, and it would destroy the finite thermal conductance in the bulk, and it would destroy thermal conductance, the quantized conductance. Now that could be relevant to the experiments also. We just don't know. Just let me just finally say, so just how does this relate to what I previously told you about the HLR and Dirac theories? So we said in the lowest lambda level, you have a Fermi surface. There's no energy gap, and things are continuous. Now I said at nu equals 5/2, there's an energy gap. How can that happen? Well, the explanation that was even given explained in some detail by Reed and Green is that you can understand, I mean, it was understood before then in some way, but they made it much more precise, that you could get an energy gap at nu equals 5/2 if you had some kind of superconducting like BCS pairing of the fermion, composite fermion, so they open up BCS-like pair gap. Okay, and you can use a BCS formalism to describe it, but it depends on the angular momentum state that you're pairing in. So within the Dirac picture, the Sohn-Dirac picture, you could distinguish between the Pfaffian, the anti-Pfaffian, and the pH-Pfaffian by the pairing angular momentum. So in that case, if you pair with L equals 0, that's a symmetric case, you get the pH-Pfaffian. L equals 2 is the Pfaffian, L equals minus 2 is the anti-Pfaffian. In HLR, where things are not particle hole symmetric to begin with, then the Pfaffian state has L equals 1, the anti-Pfaffian state has L equals minus 3, and the Pfaffian state has L equals minus 1. But of course, there's nothing that forbids, you could have perfectly well exactly the same energy for pairing an L equals minus 3 and L equals 1. It looks like a coincidence, but it's certainly allowed within HLR. So that's what happens. And of course, the difference between 5/2 and 1/2 is due to the different effective interactions in the lowest lambda level and second lambda level, just like some metals become superconductors and some don't, depending on whether there's an attractive interaction or not. Okay, well, I think that's pretty much all I want to say. Overall conclusions, we think we mostly understand what's happening at nu equals 1/2, but there are, as we've seen, subtle issues of principle that remain open, and theorists in the field are quite exercised about it. At nu equals 5/2, I think we really don't know what's going on. So we need some help.
Thank you. Question?
I have a question about the first part of your talk.
Yeah.
About this emergent symmetry.
Right.
Explained to us that the theory you have been involved in does not have particle symmetry manifestly, but some theory does have it. On the other hand, there were some quantities where there was no difference. Other
right.
quantities, there was a difference. And mm-hmm. you seem to hope that by refining your approximation, one could sort of recover particle symmetry. Now, mm-hmm. I find it difficult to reconcile this with cases where we understand emergent symmetry, let's say normalization group language, would have an Hessian Hamiltonian which does not have a symmetry,
right.
but on larger scales, you approach a fixed point which then has a symmetry.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I think it's like there are always corrections to fixed points. So
sure,
we could look
sure.
at the. So there's certain properties that are determined by the fixed point, which are particle hole symmetric, and you could say, let's look at the liquid gas transition or something like that, which you can map it onto an Ising state, but if I look at corrections, they're different. So the leading terms are the same, but the corrections are different. And somehow, I think what the feeling is that these vertex corrections, they're looking at higher order terms, that they're not looking at the dominant sigma xy, but that corrections of order k squared or order omega and so forth. And in some cases, these are determined, at least this is what the philosophy is, that they're determined not by the leading asymptotic behavior, but by what we would call corrections. And of course, the amplitude of the corrections depends on the detailed Hamiltonian. So in the Ising model, there are no corrections. In the gas-liquid transition, there are corrections.
Right? So this would mean that you believe your theory is the correct one, because if there are quantities which don't have a symmetry and the manifestly
if you add a finite mass to the Dirac theory, you can also you can also doctor the Dirac theory. I think if we can explain it in our theory, he can explain it by adding a finite mass or by adding other. He may need vertex corrections too for those quantities.
Maybe I would like to resurrect another theory which was quite old for this new equal one constant.
Yeah.
Which was probably very, very naive, much more naive than this theory, which was the dipole theory. Because I think in this dipole theory,
yes,
more or less takes very seriously the Jane's wave function.
You mean I think that these are not incompatible theories, but the dipolar theory is not precise enough to make these kinds of predictions. At the crude level, we would say that if you looked at what these renormalized quasi-particles look like, they're screened, and the screened quasi-particles can be thought of as neutral particles with a dipole. I don't think there's any incompatibility about it, and I think we can reinterpret either of these theories in terms of dipoles, certainly neutral particles with dipoles. But the question is to make precise, to calculate something like this Q squared correction to sigma xy. I wouldn't know how to do it with it. No, the dipoles don't have to be. They don't have to be particle hole symmetric. They're only asymptotically. It's only in the limit. They're particle hole symmetric in the limit of long wavelengths and low frequencies. But we're looking at corrections beyond the lowest. The leading stuff was. No, Jane's wave functions are not particle hole symmetric. They are not particle hole symmetric, but they're very close. The deviation is only 2% or 3%, but if you're a theorist, you worry about it. But also, Jane cannot calculate, the Jane trial wave functions do not calculate these kinds of transport properties. They calculate equilibrium properties and energy gaps and stuff. And everything he calculates is very close to particle hole symmetric, but it's not precise. So you could say that's evidence in favor of particle hole symmetry, that there's no broken particle hole symmetry, and I think that is good evidence that there's not particle hole symmetry. But we still have the question of why do two effective theories, which are designed to describe specifically the long wavelength, low frequency properties, somehow, how do you reconcile them? Probably when we understand it, it'll be simple. But we've had trouble trying to find corrections that we could satisfy ourselves with the correct ones.
My question was about excited states. As far as I remember, Jane's theory predicted some sequence of excited states.
Yes.
And what about these two theories, your theory and Song's theory? What does it tell about?
Well, certainly, okay, so certainly to lowest order, they're the same. The frequencies are the same. If you have the gaps, the energy gaps in the excited states, they have an energy scale which scales with delta B, the difference from nu equals a half, delta nu. And that part is the same. Now you could say, are there corrections of order delta nu squared or delta nu cubed, which are different in the theories? And now, then you really have to start asking about, I don't know the answers to all of them, but there may be some differences at some higher order. That has to be worked out. But again, you can always add corrections that are not universal that are order delta nu squared anyway, so you have to be careful about that. But I think these are questions which are not entirely the same.
Let's speak. Thank you.